In the 1980s and 1990s, the most common way to connect a device like a video game console, a VCR, or a home computer to your TV was through an RF connection. That's where the device transmits a low-power radio frequency signal through a coaxial cable to the TV's antenna input. And then you tune it in on the TV like you would a broadcast TV station. It didn't provide the best image quality, but it was simple and effective, and with the smaller screen sizes that were typical of the era, for most people the results were good enough. And it was often your only choice, because until the 1990s, many devices like cable boxes and this top-loader Nintendo console only had an RF output, and until the early 2000s, many inexpensive TVs only had an RF input. In North America, virtually all devices with an RF output gave you a choice of outputting on channel 3 or channel 4. But have you ever wondered why those two channels? After all, over in the UK, most VCRs output on channel 36, so why didn't they use that channel over here as well? Despite what you may think, it was not because of restrictions by the Federal Communications Commission. If you look up the part of the FCC rules dealing with what they call TV interface devices, it allows them to use frequencies ranging anywhere from 54 to 806 megahertz. That corresponds to anywhere from channel 2 to channel 69.
It all comes together on 69 News.
As I explained in a previous video, in the late 1980s, channel 70 and above became off-limits when they were reassigned for use by public safety services and cell phones. So why did we end up with virtually all RF modulators, such as the assortment I have here, only outputting on channels 3 or 4? Well, it comes down to what I call the three C's: compatibility, convenience, and cost. Prior to the implementation of the All Channel Receiver Act in 1964, most television sets in the US could only receive VHF channels 2 to 13. Yes, there initially was a channel 1, but it was never really used and was quickly discontinued in the late 1940s. So up until the mid-1960s, most television sets could not receive UHF channels 14 and above. And by the time the first video game consoles and VCRs were being introduced a decade later, many of those TVs remained in service, as evidenced by the fact that Radio Shack continued to sell a converter box for adding UHF to a VHF-only set until 1976. And just because television receivers made after 1964 were required to receive UHF channels does not mean it was required to receive them all simultaneously, as you can see by these two VCRs from the mid-1980s, which give you VHF channels 2 to 13, then two spaces for programming in UHF channels. If there were more than two UHF channels in your area that you wanted to receive, you could reprogram one of the unoccupied VHF channels to UHF, but that required opening up a trapdoor and manually tuning it in using these tiny switches and knobs, which was not an easy process. So for compatibility and convenience, it made sense to use an RF modulator, which outputs on VHF instead of UHF. But VHF is actually two separate bands. As you might have seen on the tuning dial of a small portable TV or a radio with TV audio capability, it is split up into VHF Low, which extends from 54 to 88 MHz and includes channels 2 to 6, and VHF High, which extends from 174 to 216 MHz and includes channels 7 to 13. In fact, in the early years of television, it was common to use two separate antennas, a larger one for VHF low and a smaller one for VHF high. It would be impractical for RF modulators to cover both VHF low and VHF high because the frequencies involved are so different. So they have to pick one or the other, and that's where cost becomes an issue. Because the higher the frequencies you want to use, the tighter the tolerances are in design and manufacturing, and you also need to use higher quality, more expensive components which are rated to operate at those higher frequencies. All the same reasons why computers with faster CPUs are more expensive than slower ones. And that consideration even applies to the thickness of the cable going from the RF modulator to your TV, because the higher the frequencies you want to transmit through that cable, the thicker the insulation needs to be to prevent the signal from being lost and leaking out of the cable. So here is an RF cable designed for carrying all VHF and UHF TV frequencies, and as you can see, that's pretty thick. Needless to say, if you had a cable this thick going from your video game console to your TV, that would be rather cumbersome, especially if you had it on the floor or your coffee table, as people often did. This would be a pretty bad trip hazard. But if you look at the cable that actually goes from the Nintendo to the TV, it's a lot thinner, and yet the picture on the TV is still perfectly clear, and this cable is 10 feet long. That's because the Nintendo's RF modulator is using VHF low, where the leakage effect is much less than it is at higher frequencies, allowing them to use a thinner cable. So now we know why RF modulators use VHF low. But why always channels 3 and 4? Well, first of all, that's not actually always the case. For example, older Atari computers and video game consoles, like this Atari 400, give a choice of channels 2 and 3 instead of 3 and 4. When using an RF modulator, you want to pick a channel that's not already in use in your area by a broadcast TV station, because that would cause interference. And if you look at a chart of the VHF low band in the top 20 TV markets in the US back in the 1980s, the two channels with the least amount of stations on them were Channel 3 and Channel 6. So those obviously would be the best channels to use for an RF modulator. So you may ask, why didn't RF modulators use Channel 6 if that's an unoccupied channel in most cities? Well, one problem with Channel 6 is that it actually slightly overlaps with the bottom of the FM radio band, because the audio carrier on Channel 6 TV is at 87.75 MHz, which most FM radios can tune in at the bottom of the dial. Many TV stations on Channel 6 used to promote this fact as a way to listen to them in your car.
For 14 years, our viewers have tuned into 87.7 on the radio dial to hear NBC6 broadcasts.
Another live update is coming your way in 25 minutes.
And because many TV tuners aren't very selective, it can happen the other way too. I remember the Philco TV my parents had in the 80s being able to pick up the audio from an FM radio station on 88.3 when I tuned it to Channel 6. In fact, some radios with TV audio reception put VHF low and FM radio together on the same band due to their proximity. So that leaves Channel 3 as the most logical choice for use by RF modulators, because it works on all TVs, is not occupied by a TV station in most cities, and doesn't have any interference problems with FM radio. And actually, some early RF modulators for use with personal computers only output on Channel 3 and did not give you a choice of an alternate channel. So if you were unlucky enough to live in Philadelphia or Cleveland, you either had to tolerate the interference or save up for a video monitor. But of course, it was far superior for the modulator to offer an alternate channel in case Channel 3 was occupied in your area. And again, that could be either Channel 2 if you had an Atari, or Channel 4 if you had a Commodore or almost anything else. And I can't find any technical reason why one choice would be preferred over the other. The only thing I can think of that would tip the scales in favor of channels 3 and 4 becoming the standard selections for RF modulators instead of channels 2 and 3 is the fact that in Chicago, both channels 3 and 4 are unoccupied. So if those are your two choices, the residents of one of the biggest cities in the US wouldn't need to worry about which position the switch is in. It would work equally well either way. So instead of 25 or 6, 2, 4, I think that's why Channel 3 became the preferred channel for RF modulators, with Channel 4 as the backup. But that's not to say other choices were never available, because here's an RF modulator that's in almost exactly the same case as this typical one that puts out channels 3 and 4, except this one is a UHF modulator. and it puts out a signal on channel 14. Very strange. And the aforementioned SuperMod modulator, which was originally only on channel 3, solved the interference problem by moving to channel 33, and they later added an adjustment to go between channels 32 and 34. I guess the people in Youngstown, Ohio must have complained. And today we could be enjoying uncompressed, unencrypted, digital Ultra HD video over the same kind of single coaxial cable that we previously used for analog RF, if only us mere mortals were allowed to use SDI, Serial Digital Interface, which professionals in the broadcasting industry have been using since the 1990s. But we can't have that because somebody somewhere could have used it to make an unauthorized copy of Blade Runner instead of paying to buy it on Blu-ray or stream it.